So tonight's the recap and the conclusion of the series. And hopefully I'll have you stick around for a little bit at the very end and we can get some last comments and suggestions from you. I found a really funny, crazy recap of the blockchain history on TechCrunch this summer, and I laughed so hard I thought I somehow have got to include that in my presentation. So last night of our conference here, I'm going to talk about it. And so I've taken it as an original source, and so the credit goes to this guy, John Evans. And I kind of spun off my own bit on it as well, but mostly it comes from him. October 2008, pseudonymous figure or group called Satoshi Nakamoto publishes a white paper entitled Bitcoin, a peer-to-peer electronic cash system. This introduces a new data structure called the blockchain. The next 8 years we'll see it create billions of dollars of value, cause intelligent people to seriously speculate that it could be used to replace the entire global financial system. There's the white paper. The mystery of Satoshi Nakamoto's identity is never solved. Compared to much of what follows, this all seems pretty reasonable and plausible. The first real world purchase occurs in Jacksonville, Florida, where a too large Papa John pepperoni pizza sold for 10,000 bitcoins. Today, what's that worth? Around $12 million. Well, I said 11 million, but that was before the big price run up today. In celebration of this historic event, May 22nd is now recognized by Bitcoin fans worldwide as Bitcoin Pizza Day. And a lot of places will give you free pizza if you pay in Bitcoin. That doesn't make sense. Much of the academic world in spring 2011 discovers Bitcoin. Reactions range from, this is a giant scam, to, this is the most dangerous project we have ever seen, to, this is the greatest hope of liberty, to, oh my word, these guys are crazy. Each of these contradictory statements and viewpoints are surprisingly convincing. In spring of 2011, Senator Chuck Schumer holds a big press conference naming Bitcoin as the currency being primarily used to purchase drugs on the darknet sites such as Silk Road, Photo Op.
You need some music, I guess. Dun, 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 dun.
The traditional reaction to the moral census ensues. The price of Bitcoin immediately rises to almost 40-fold in 10 weeks as all these new drug addicts go, what? Bitcoin? Silk Road? Thanks, Chuck.
Chucky.
The rest of 2011, Mt. Gox, a Bitcoin exchange originally set up to trade Magic the Gathering game cards, is hacked. People keep using Mt. Gox because, well, you know, why the heck? Why not? What could possibly go wrong? November 2011, the price of Bitcoin had fallen down to $2, losing over 90% of its former value. Mt. Gox crashes, which will become common. Wired magazine calls the currency dead. It would be Bitcoin's seventh obituary. Over 100 more obituaries will follow. In March of 2013, most Bitcoin aficionados will tell you in a tone usually reserved for the tales of death, wars, famines, and pestilence that this is the day the hard fork occurred in the Bitcoin blockchain. Well, there's never technically ever been a fork in the Bitcoin blockchain. Also, the famous Winklevoss twins from Facebook's lawsuit reportedly own 1% of all Bitcoin. They launched the Winklevoss Bitcoin Trust ETF. After 3 years, it's still waiting for approval from the SEC, where we're going to find out by March 10th, right? Meanwhile, their ex-friend Mark Zuckerberg, CEO of Facebook, becomes the sixth richest person in the world. They're still screwed. January 2014, the New York Times publishes Why Bitcoin Matters by the billionaire investor Mark Andreessen. The same Mark Andreessen that invented the web browser. He argues correctly that Bitcoin offers a sweeping vista of opportunity to reimagine how the financial system can and should work in the internet era. Meanwhile, however, Much of the early Bitcoin community is still using Mt. Gox Exchange, coded in PHP by developers of extremely dubious technical ability. This despite months of warnings of delayed fund transfer by many on several Bitcoin forums. I knew about it. February 2014, shockingly, Mt. Gox shuts down and files for bankruptcy, reporting the loss of 850,000 Bitcoins at the time, worth $700 million. Some weeks later, they actually rediscover 200,000 of them behind a couch cushion.
But no one really knew who Nakamoto was in real life until yesterday, when Newsweek reporter Leah McGrath Goodman outed the person she thinks invented the world's most successful digital currency. This guy, 64-year-old Dorian Prentice Satoshi Nakamoto. And then shit got crazy. Journo showed up at the physicist slash engineer slash computer genius slash model train enthusiast's home in Temple City, California. He told them he was ready for a free lunch.
Why did you create Bitcoin, sir? Okay, no questions, but now I'm not like you want.
Sir, can I ask you about Bitcoin? Why are we involved with Bitcoin?
Okay, I'm not involved in Bitcoin. Okay?
Who's involved in Bitcoin?
Wait a minute. I'm up for you on first. I'm going to go with you.
He hopped into a light blue Prius and drove off with Ryan Nakashima, a reporter at Associated Press. And they did have lunch at Mako Sushi in Arcadia. But the pack kept after them, and finally they took refuge at the AP's headquarters in Los Angeles. And while the journals on the outside tweeted, shuffled, and selfied, Nakamoto and Nakashima talked for 2 whole hours. Then Nakashima announced that Nakamoto said that he is not the man behind Bitcoin after all, and hadn't even heard of it until 3 weeks ago, which no one believes. But he is trying. And then the interwebs went ablaze with geek spew. So what do you think? Is it him?
More of our crazy history. The model train set aficionado named Dorian Nakamoto is outed by Newsweek as the creator of Bitcoin. Dozens of news crews from around the world quickly descend on Nakamoto's home that he shared with his elderly mother in California. It soon appears that Newsweek is flagrantly, painfully, stupidly wrong. In August 2015, Ethereum, a new cryptocurrency, launches. It's basically founded on the precept that, well, Bitcoin's just been too timid and unambitious, or at least insufficiently brash, weird, and disruptive. The scripting language that controls its monetary transfers is Turing complete, which by definition means, well, it's impossible to tell whether its programs will run forever or eventually halt. To analyze, Bitcoin only offers its developers a knife with which you can stab yourself, while Ethereum offers developers the entire arsenal of the United States military with which it can destroy everything that they've ever loved. Like Bitcoin, Ethereum is both technically fascinating and generally awesome. December 2015, Craig Wright. New clues suggest that Craig Wright, suspected Bitcoin creator, may be a hoaxer. The Australian man noticed Craig Wright is mysteriously outed as Satoshi Nakamoto, unnamed by unnamed sources, possibly by Wright himself. It soon becomes painfully apparent that either Wright is a con man, or Satoshi is doing absolutely everything he can do to convince the world that he is a con man. January 2016, Bitcoin was round a failure as the media erupts over the Mike Kern exit. Mike Kern was a senior Bitcoin developer. He was frustrated by the lack of progress for raising the block size limit. He announced, Bitcoin has failed. He rage quits the community and announced that he sold all his Bitcoins. Many mainstream news reports quickly jump on that and announce, Bitcoin is dead. That rose Bitcoin obituaries to about 85. Just over a year later, the price has almost tripled in value. In April 2016, Slockit, the German startup that creates Slocks, which are smart blocks that can remotely open when they receive digital money over the internet, they announce a side project called the world's first distributed autonomous organization built on Ethereum. It would be a computer program called the DAO. It was intended to raise Ether and then invest that based on its token holders' votes, with no further human decisions or intervention required. Their announcement refers, in a soon-to-be ironic self-congratulatory manner, its irrefutable computer code, reviewed by the best security audit company in the world. It's self-governing and not influenced by outside forces. Its software operates on its own, with its bylaws immutably written on the blockchain, not controlled by its creators. In May 2016, people claim, with an apparent straight face, the DAO will soon become the greatest threat banks have ever faced. Optimistic investors pour a whopping $150 million into the DAO because, well, you know, what the heck, why not? What could possibly go wrong? June 2016. Craig Wright, the aforementioned Australian, sure looks like a common outs himself as Satoshi Nakamoto, and even managed to convince Gavin Andreessen, the last developer to actually communicate through email with Satoshi. Con men can be very convincing. Some well-respected researchers identify a fundamental flaw in the DAO's voting protocol and vote for a moratorium on DAO projects until they can be resolved. A potential flaw in the theory of smart contract scripts is identified in the DAO, and everyone is assured, well, it's quickly fixed. 3 days later, the DAO was hacked. Nearly two-thirds of its money is siphoned away. Who could have possibly seen a thing like that coming? Spring 2016 also, the crypto world worries about the upcoming halving, where the amount of Bitcoin rewarded to miners drops by half. This was estimated to happen at the first weekend in July. Some estimated that half of all miners would be forced to quit the network because it would no longer be profitable. Further, they theorized that the backlog of unconfirmed transactions would create a death spiral and Bitcoin would never recover. Almost as if by an invisible hand provided help, that the price mysteriously rose to the amount needed for the miners to continue to make a profit as the halving happened. The blockchain world held their collective breath as nothing dramatic happened. The trust machine just continued to chug along. Was that coincidence? Ethereum, July to October 2016. The very same people who recently were trumpeting irrefutable computer code, not influenced by outside forces, not controlled by its creators, immediately called for the intervention of its creators and outside forces to repair the damage caused by the computer code contract. Well, to their credit, they seemed fairly embarrassed by that. Eventually, a controversial hard fork ensued, and some resistant miners, reportedly influenced by the Ethereum-hating Bitcoiners, refused to process that new chain. They argued more brightly that the bad code wasn't anything to do with the Ethereum blockchain. It was only a badly written contract. The hacker cashes out tokens on the old chain and gets away, despite being chased by the posse of white hackers. The white hat hackers, I should say. As a measurement of revenge, the hacker then spams the Ethereum network by creating millions of new but empty addresses, which require two more months and two more forks to clean up. The one-year-old Ethereum stumbles but grows more resilient. Developers become more humble and wiser about the possibility that they might accidentally create Skynet. Dun, dun, dun. So that's our first break, and I wanted to have time, a good amount of time, to talk about the course and to answer questions, because as Bob mentioned, you're going to learn enough to be dangerous in this class. And I want to make sure that I kind of help steer you out of trouble before I just let you go and go break yourself. You know, Bitcoin hit its all-time high today, and a lot of people get tempted. You see this classic time again and again. And Mark Twain said, it's not the things you don't know that get you in trouble. It's the things you know for sure that just ain't so. So the biggest thing about Bitcoin in times like this is to see the price going up like a rocket and they want to jump on that thing. It's going to the moon. And this is what we call fear of missing out. And it's probably the most dangerous time to ever jump in and start spending away like you're going to miss out on all the riches to come. So I know it's tempting, I've done it too. But be careful, every time you see a rocket go up, it comes down just about as fast. And Bitcoin, the history of that is predictable, let's just say that. So at some point, you know, you kind of watch for those corrections. But if you're thinking like me, well, this time it's different. Every time, you know, sometimes it comes back down and it never comes back down, right? How could it be $1,200 without coming back down and still going up? Never went back to zero. So, I mean, I get some of that where you know, when you try and guess that, you're usually wrong. So unless you're a professional trader, you do this for a living and you've done it for years, just wait till it calms down. Ethereum, kind of, there's a lot of them kind of follow in the same footsteps. If you're looking on the charts, there Ethereum went up big time, dashed. You know, it's not uncommon to see these things go up 10-20% in a day, but then, you know, they can drop 10-20% in a day too. A lot of people call that a good year. You know, you get 10% a year, you know, you just rocked it. But in this world that we're in, things move very, very fast. And a lot of people are speculating that SEC we talked about with the Winklevoss twins is going to pass. So there's a lot of built-in momentum and built-in price expectation that's going to pass, but there's no guarantee that it will. I'll give you a little more background on that. There needs to be three people vote on that. That's on the SEC board. It's been denied several times. It's been up. It was put up originally 3 years ago. It's been denied over and over and over again because there's nothing ever been like Bitcoin before. This is brand new territory, and the mining is mostly controlled in China, which they have no control over. So they're trying to figure out how to deal with this. They have a lot of people, pros and cons, coming in and either scaring them or telling them this is the greatest thing in the world. And the head of the three is retired now. And so they only have two people to do it. So which, you know, there's no tie-breaking vote there if you have two people in a disagreement. And generally, even if they get a third person, the chair hired before then, they're not going to want to take on something so unusual and so risky that they're going to go weigh in on a vote when everybody else has been trying to figure it out for a couple of years. Then there are four other funds that are right after the Winklevoss. So you're going to have a lineup of these wanting to pass an ETF for Bitcoin. So if they don't answer now, they're just going to be deluged with the next and the next and the next. So a lot of people are thinking they're just going to have to deal with it. The next ones might make a little bit of adjustment based on the findings that they have. But the other option is they could decide not to vote at all on it, which I think is kind of likely. Because if they don't take a stand on it and vote, it passes automatically. And so they may not want to dip their toes in there and do something controversial and raise, you know, their voice. And it'll just pass quietly without anybody saying anything. So I think that you're going to see a lot of the price that's happening today is that sort of expectation. They only need two, and they may just look at each other and say, I don't know what to do. Do you know what to do? They're shrugging their shoulders, I don't know what to do. So rather than vote it down and then be, you know, hated by all these Bitcoiners, they'll probably, you know, there's a good chance they can just be quiet and let it go. So I read another report that says if they let this go and this passes, the mutual fund people and the experts out there on Wall Street say expect $300 million to be sent into Bitcoin the first week. So $300 million added on to the, you know, Bitcoin doesn't have a whole lot of coins available. Somebody asked, well, you know, what happens if I want to buy a million Bitcoins? And I said, you can't. There's only maybe, you know, 100,000 of that liquid. And then they get progressively much, much more expensive the further out you go. So you can see the price double pretty easily if someone wanted to sink $300 million into it. So a lot of people are, if you're missing out on that, you know, price double. So one other interesting thing I found that you just might be interested in, I'm not necessarily recommending this, but there's a Bitcoin IRA. And they allow you to do a Roth IRA on it, which means you pay them with already taxed dollars. And then when you retire, you pull that out untaxed. Now, you know my feeling about the guess on the price of Bitcoin in 10 years. Think of the odds or think about the possibility of pulling that out in 10 years tax-free. So that struck me very interesting as I decided to think about that. So anyway, Bitcoin IRA, if you get interested, I'm not suggesting it myself, but that's just what I did. We'll see. Hopefully I get in there before it's $1 million a piece. Marty has a question for you.
ETF is denied.
can the Winkle boss change stuff in it and reapply?
He asked if it's denied by the SEC, can the Winkle boss change some things that they might have a problem with and reapply? Yeah, that's what's happened for the last 2 years. They'll give them, they'll deny them, they'll say, well, and then the last time was, who's pricing this thing? You've got your own Winkle boss fund that does the pricing, and then you're doing, you know, setting an ETF on it too. Yeah, that's a conflict of interest. You can't be doing the pricing and then, you know, set up the ETF based on your own deal. So they had to find another source to issue and come up with the pricing scheme of it, and then so there could be no conflict of interest there. But they might find something else. You know, each time they've been up for about every 3 months, they get a new ruling, and then they go change a little bit of the documentation and resubmit. So who knows what they'll find next time. Their head lawyer quit recently. I don't know if he quit or got fired or whatever. His opinion was it's not going to be passed. He's not on the team anymore. He says there's just too many unknowns. It may be a year or two before, you know, it's proven itself enough that they'll take the risk of letting people do that. So that was his opinion. So there's a lot of things up in the air about that, and you're going to see the price fluctuate heavily because of that. And as I've told you a lot of times, price is kind of the least interesting thing. After all of the stuff we've talked about, machine of trust, and all the funny, goofy stories that happen and weaving in and out, you could make three movies of it. How about the Silk Road and capturing the, you know, Ross Ulbricht, and then having this Secret Service and the other federal official get arrested because they were stealing bitcoins that were on the case first, like thinking they were going to get away with it. So, twists and turns. Anybody have questions about what we've talked about so far?
There is a TV series that has something kind of like that.
He says that there's a TV series. Mr. Robot.
Yeah.
Have anybody seen Mr. Robot? It's one of my favorite shows now. Very cool. I think it's on USA Network. I can't remember what it's on. I'm not saying I did torrent it. I'm not saying I didn't. I'm just wondering, you know, I don't know how it got there. But I watched Mr. Robot. And it's about a hacker and a lot of things that we've talked about. And in the second season, they really get into digital currencies. You know, the world economy kind of crashes, whatever. The big banks, he wants to take him down. He's a super hacker, dude. Anyway, really cool. I suggest it. In fact, it wins all kinds of awards now. It's kind of the big TV show right now.
Can you explain more about how the Dow was supposed to make money and, you know, how it was supposed to make decisions on investing?
Right. Okay. So Marty asked on the Dow for Ethereum, and I think we're going to talk about that some more as we do our review. But the idea was we're going to put a bunch of money out here to be a venture capitalist. We really want to encourage new companies in the Ethereum space to help build the ecosystem. We really have, there's some people out there with some really good ideas. So we'll help them do their ICOs. So the company Slocket was going to do their ICO for their own DAO, which is going to create these little blocks like we kind of talked about. They thought, well, we want to be the Airbnb. We want to put these little electronic blocks on things, and they were making it so you could put it on anything and share your lawnmower or whatever. And then they'd be sent by time, and people could pay you through Bitcoin, and it would automatically unlock these locks. And then when the rent was over or whatever, they would, you know, then lock themselves back up. And from what I understand, that company's still here. They're still refining that. They're still trying to do it. But in the meantime, they thought, well, we're going to do this ICO. We're going to do it right. We've got to figure this all out. But, you know, we don't want to do that. Other people want to use this technology too. So we're going to do it, figure it all out. And then, hey, let's just spin this off as another company. Because since we're doing it all anyway, let's just commoditize this idea. And there's a lot of people that are really excited for Slocket. And we don't really know how to just limit it at all. So anyway, they spun it off into its own DAO. And the idea was they were going to have what they called curators be able to go through as everybody wants to, you know, submit their new company, get a token, and become their own DAO. And you get a lot of junk out there, right? You get people want to do just pyramid schemes and garbage. So they said, well, why don't we have a curator group, a little group of really smart people like Vitalik himself, and some of the people that were the core Ethereum creators, and then they'll have people submit their ideas to them, and they'll just like start throwing away the crap, and then, you know, find those really good two or three handfuls that really show promise, and then we'll put those up for a vote. And anybody that owns these tokens called the DAO tokens has voting rights. So they can say, okay, well, here's selection A, B, and C. Here's why we think they're good. They've all given us white paper. You can read the white paper. Now, if you own this token, you get a right to vote and you have a say in that company. You'll actually become a token owner. So you'll retain the DAO tokens and you'll own a right, a piece of that new company, the new ICO, the new the decentralized autonomous organization. So you can use that as an income stream. So you'll be a part owner and you'll get dividends and whatnot be paid to you, but you still, you can either hold that DAO token on its own or sell it. It becomes its own identity. So that was the idea behind it. And then the big key was, oh, you don't, it's not a risk because you can write yourself this little child contract and send the DAO token back to yourself, send the Ethereum back to you and you, you know, whatever. So there's no risk to you. So, you know, hey, that's a great idea. I don't exactly know how these contract works, but I'm sure somebody does, and I'll just kind of copy what they did. That was my thinking. And then it kind of went south, as we talked about. So more questions?
Just one comment with Mr. Robot. There was actually a new TV series that was created called Startup.
Movie? Oh, it's actually
supposed to be more about starting a altcoin. So they don't call Bitcoin, but I think it follows along the same.
Right. I saw previews on that, maybe even the first episode, a little bit of it. They started a company, and it was heavily referenced in the concept of Bitcoin. You know, this is going to be the currency that changes the world. And, you know, they're using a lot of the lines that you'll read exactly verbatim on Bitcoin forums. And they create this fictitional company. And the television show is called Startup. And what, do you remember what station that's on? It's on the
Crackle,
right? Yeah, I saw the first one early. Is it a good series? I mean,
I don't know.
The first one I thought was, we'll see. You know, it was okay, wasn't it? It wasn't good enough that I would, you know, put, you know, mark it on my schedule and go make sure I didn't miss the second one. But it's interesting to see these concepts take hold and people run with it. Okay, so now we're going to do the recap. I'm kind of going to go over the last five chapters that we did, just at a very high level. But I want to keep this open for you to ask questions as we do this, because I'm just going to hit the tops of it again, thinking that you're probably going to have questions from the time we first talked about this. And now you're going to have some context. Now we've gone, you know, talked about, when we first talked about Bitcoin, you didn't know about Ethereum, right? So you didn't really have, you can really compare to something you didn't know about. So now when we talk about Bitcoin, and you've had some time to digest it, we talk about its blockchain and we broke it down and got some technical stuff out of the way. Let's review that now. So about wallets, since we were just talking about that, the blockchain tokens are stored on the ledger, not your various wallets. Only the keys that access those tokens are stored there. Hardware wallets are backed up by those seed words. They're the most secure for the end-to-end encryption. Paper wallets need to have multiple backups stored in different physical locations to be stored. Now, hardware wallets, they're, you know, the key is on hardware itself. That's the key right there. The hardware, the chips themselves, as long as you trust the chip manufacturer and, you know, bad entities didn't get in there and actually write software to get on that hardware, you can't beat that. And that's what they're going to make onto the Internet of Things devices that are going to have hardware in there that store a private key that you can't break. That's in hardware. So, Marty?
Can you comment on the error that they found this morning on the VIP 32?
Oh, yeah. Okay, so in the news today, Marty says, well, they found an error they call it VIP 32. These are the Bitcoin improvement proposals that we talked about. These are the ideas, the white papers that get submitted, and then when everybody likes it, they write it into the code. Well, one of the improvement processes was how to deal with these the passwords. And of course, they put out guidelines, but the wallet makers themselves have the other side of that puzzle. So the Bitcoin has a reference model. They say, okay, here's your jigs and there's your jags, and now you got to make your jigs and jags match with that. And there's some interpretation by the programmers of exactly how they zig and zag. And Mt. Gox is a good example of that. They had to do transfer of the funds themselves and go out there into the stream so they could be verified. And they found something called malleability that they were able to kind of change the format of how the headers and the things that worked on there. And so one of the developers put it, Gavin Anderson put it pretty nicely. He says, we created this token that had enough rough edges that if you weren't careful, you could jack yourself on it. And Mount Gox, the guy wasn't a very good programmer, so he used some of the code that wasn't really smooth and got caught doing some shortcuts. And so the wallet, what you're referencing today was a wallet implementation from, I think, one or two wallet makers that did something that wasn't exactly right. And I can't remember the wallet maker now off the top of my head, but...
CoinPay or BitPay?
Yeah, BitPay. So they're having people resend those to another wallet, basically. So if you have coins in one of these wallets that you recommend, recreating a seed, and then from scratch, whatever, move those to another coin, another wallet. And if you want to keep using that same wallet, redo this, because I guess they fixed their wallet now. And so, you know, you would want to move the coins that are sitting there. So, and we mentioned this, and I base a lot of this off of John McAfee's speech. If you did YouTube on John McAfee and Bitcoin, you would see him talking about this. Phone wallets should only be used for current spending money amounts on the phone itself. They should always be considered infected at all times. And he used the example that he bought, you know, he used 3 or 4 or 5 wallets on his phone just because he's in the business. He wants to see how long it takes for people to hack him. And he puts the amount of Bitcoin in each one of these wallets. Mycelium was one. And he had Jack's, and you know, he had some others. He said, you know, by the time that night, he installed that software, by that night, they were all stolen. Of course, he makes himself a target, obviously. John McAfee, you know, the target, you know, the hacker's guy, you know, he's going to have a target on his back. But he says that they can do screenshots. He says, you know, a lot of the websites you visit will have an insert Java code right on your phone and will be taking screenshots the entire time. So when you build that seed the very first time, someone was recording that. Of course, they're going to sit there and wait in quiet until you load it up. You're not going to see them break in right away. So my suggestion is, keep a little bit of spending money in your phone wallet if you're going to, but even the seed words, your backup on your using a phone wallet isn't necessarily secure. I really recommend the Trezor or the Keepkey or a hardware wallet, even over the paper wallets. Evaluating the future value of Bitcoin. Bitcoin is a deflating asset, and its creation slows over time at a rate that isn't expected to replace lost or destroyed or stolen bitcoins. Demand deflating currencies tend to become more valuable over time. People see more use for this thing. People are finding new ways to use Bitcoin. It becomes the machine of trust. It's the token of trust. It's going to get a following. It's going to get more people learning to trust that over time. Yet, there will be people that lose their paper wallets, that get burned. They'll send them to unspendable addresses. That was a common thing at the very first. They goof up a number or two and you can spend it into oblivion. See it on the blockchain there forever taunting you that no one's ever going to spend it again. They're ghost Bitcoin. So those kinds of things mean that they're going to be less and less over time. And you know what happens to the price though, right? Demand increases, supply actually decreases. It's slowing down by now, but it's going to be decreasing as people accidentally bury their hard drives in the dumps. Programmable money traits will be adding time-bound dimensions, multi-party signatures, among other things, ingenious kinds of inventions that are coming still. They're expected to give Bitcoin even more usefulness, increasing demand even further. And as I mentioned, the supply is hard, limited, bound. And now, today, as we see, it passed the price of gold. Why not? It's becoming seen as a safe asset in times of turmoil and trouble. And we certainly have seen our times of turmoil lately. The Trump election, you know, it shot up. You know, the Brexit happens, shoots up. When you see, just in the form of life, we're going to see wars break out and unexpected things. And the financial world always gets rocked, and this is going to trade opposite to the stock market and become stronger because of that. People will be going, when you have your inevitable crashes, and we're due, people are going to be running for the hills looking for someplace safe while they wait it out. Well, this is becoming an easy to get to safe place because you can trade it in seconds. It's traded all over the world. Markets are open 24 hours a day. And so it's going to be a safe place to run for the hills. So you're going to see stuff, you're going to see it skyrocket, and then that's going to create its own spiral effect. you're gonna see people that get the fear of missing out as this starts to spike. Everybody's gonna wanna climb on board, and it's gonna skyrocket, and you're gonna be feeling it too, just like everybody, I'll probably be feeling too. Get in before it's too expensive to get in again, and then just expect it, it's gonna crash. That's the nature of the beast. This is a baby technology still. And there's a lot of traders, and there's a lot of professionals that are smarter than us that will get in there and just play the game. And so just be careful. I've taught you enough to be dangerous. What is a Bitcoin? Select your best answer, because people will ask me. And if they ask you, what is a Bitcoin? What are you gonna tell them? You've just been through, you know, 16 hours of blockchain technology. And are you any closer to telling people what a Bitcoin today than you were the very first? I've been at this for 4 years, and when people ask me how, I can't have polite conversations because I can't do it 5 or 10 minutes. And my wife's heard me try to do it so many times that she's now, whatever you do when you're around Mark, don't say the B word. Okay, is it, now raise your hand if you think this is the most accurate, is it a currency that you're able to spend and use it to trade for other items as defined by many countries? They call it a currency. They don't charge tax on it because, well, you don't charge tax on currencies. Anybody say it's a currency? Best answer? Well, you don't even know what we got next. Is it a money? Holds its value across the borders and wasn't created through a government decree? You say it's a money, not a currency, asset? Is it a commodity, as there is a limited supply and it has intrinsic value? That's how the IRS defines it, a commodity.
They changed it to a currency.
No, they still consider it a commodity. What's that?
Currency is fiat.
Right, currency is fiat. You don't tax fiat, but you do tax commodities. And since this has intrinsic value, as we talked about all the different ways that it's used, it creates the machine of trust. Now you've tokenized trust. That becomes your currency, that becomes tokenized trust, is the value. Is it a shared ledger of transactions that's public and private at the same time? If someone told you you could have the most public ledger in the world that everybody could see, yet the most private ledger anybody could ever imagine because of the hashing and double hashing and triple hashings, could you believe that? It's the most odd thing to say. They're mutually exclusive, aren't they? Yet we have it. Is it the most powerful supercomputer ever created on the worldwide massive scale, created to protect the records of truth in the world's trust machine? Is that your best answer? Anybody? Is it a storage container for transporting national currencies across borders without a bank? Certainly acts like that. Is it a block of data that contains 100 million subunits of individually addressable data addresses? Which would you say is the best answer? All, obviously all true. Which do you tell your friend or your neighbor? Which what is Bitcoin? Which one of these do you tell them? If you want to have a polite conversation that lasts 5 minutes. And not blow their head, not bend their mind so much that they look at you like you're a weirdo and walk away. Don't say anything.
It's internet money.
Magic internet money.
I would say it's the next replacement for the dollar.
Replacement for dollar. Bitcoin or any of the blockchain currencies? Can there be more than one? By the show of hands, how many believe Bitcoin will be it? The one and only one standing at the end of the day, and everybody's going to go to it and it becomes, you know, the last one standing. Anybody think that? There's a lot of Bitcoin maximists, they call them. Bitcoin can do everything the rest of these can do. You can say, hey, that's a great technology. I guess we'll do it too. The Zcash, the Zerocash, the DAP, you know, all that stuff, sure. Why don't you go ahead and experiment with that for a couple of years? If it's still around and people still like it, we'll just write our code and use that. Sure, they can do that. I think Bitcoin is going to be one last standing, if not the only one. I don't think it would be the last one. I think we're in a world of blockchains. It's a new paradigm. And it started it. It's the leader, and it's got network effect, but it's got limitations. And so we'll see. It's going to be interesting. Remember, we're less than 10 years old, and I think Gmail itself took over 10 years before Google finally released it out of beta. Gmail, right? So we're younger than Gmail here. Non-currency uses of Bitcoin. This was chapter 6. Is anybody interested? If I do redo chapter 6, is there anybody interested in coming and actually watching that? Because I wanted to really videotape it, I didn't get it on camera, and I've had some technical problems. And this was probably my favorite chapter to do. This is the one that blew me away as I got into it. So it's fun. I'll probably do it. I might give myself a mental break for a couple of weeks. But you guys are on my email list, so I'll let you know. Healthcare, that's the big one. Universal electronic healthcare records. Clinical trial audits, anonymous genomics. There are a lot of companies already working, a lot of companies already working on them. There are consortiums going. IBM holds the biggest consortium with on Fabric on their distributed ledger. And they're probably well over 100 now of healthcare companies that are riding that train, and they're working on common protocols. Property and identity, immutable public records of ownership, real and intellectual property. We didn't really go into intellectual property, but you can tokenize your creative license. If you create a song, you can tokenize that song and watch when people are using it. They become your fan base. Why don't you create an ICO as you're an artist? You know, if I'm Madonna, I hate Madonna, but if I'm some artist out there, Foo Fighters, and I can create my own coin. And people that own my coin get to listen to my music, whatever, and they get access to my website, and they get, you know, the unreleased stuff or whatever, and I can trace and track, and they can trade those coins amongst other fans. But you can tokenize your popularity and your artistic abilities. Tokenized personal data could be sold to advertisers rather than the big data ownership. We talked about this big time last time. Rather than having Facebook and Google own your identity and become hugely rich, the most, you know, financially successful companies in the world right now, take back your identity. Create a smart contract for yourself, put it in a contract wallet, so all the advertisers see is this wallet address. And the new Google and the new Facebook replacements will utilize that. They'll be peer-to-peer. You think Facebook's going to want to do that? If you see all the companies that jumped on the bandwagon for blockchain, right? IBM, you got Microsoft, you got all these big companies, all this kind of momentum. Do you see glaring people that aren't into blockchain? Facebook, Google. It breaks their whole business model. They want to know everything about you, and then they sell that, and they become very rich. Mark Zuckerberg's the sixth richest person in the world because he sells your data to advertisers. Now, when you take back on the new Facebook, as somebody creates it, that says, you know what? Facebook has got the network effect. It's got everybody there. I mean, what was the Google? Google Plus, they were late to the market, didn't do anything really spectacular, kind of failed. But as people, and you see the headlines today, I saw people are getting stressed by social media. It's creating an unhappy world for them now. So you'll see people kind of start dropping off, and there'll be something new that comes up as all technology has a life and the S curve and they slow down or whatever. And one of the big things I think is going to come up is privacy. They are sick and tired of having their privacy exposed to everybody. And they read the, you know, Edward Snowden, and they read all the NSA stuff, and they could track you. And I guess there's a television show someone was telling me about that they challenged somebody to stay off somebody's camera and be located for 48 hours or something. So they have different teams. It's a reality show. And then as soon as they get, you know, a license plate or a facial recognition or whatever, they're out. And so it's a sort of a, you know, reality show, game show kind of thing. I can't. Does anybody know the name? What that's called? Someone was telling me at dinner last night. And so your people are recognizing that. It gets in the news, gets in the media a lot more. And as soon as blockchain becomes big enough, and as soon as a company comes out there, decentralized autonomous organization that says, hey, look, why don't you create this little contract identity for you? We're going to create this new Facebook type of thing, and it's going to be run decentralized, and it's not going to be run by a person that's going to get all your money. But you know what? Once it gets popular, advertisers are going to want you bad. And you create a tokenized version of yourself that you can let them know who the real person is, or not let them know who the real person is. But they'll see that you're gaining popularity because other people will be attracted and be sending, you know, information to your tokenized address, your contract address. And that entity, which will be sort of a shaded outline of you, not the real you, but a representation of you, will be all of a sudden getting offers for for money, for influence, and you can let people know, and you can have several identities, right? You can have an identity, a contract for your friends, one for, you know, your school or whatever. And there'll be these companies that develop in the world that you could barely imagine. They're doing everything peer-to-peer on those mesh networks that we talked about. And that's how you're going to take back your identity as we go forward. It'll be, you know, it's going to be a struggle because the governments and the people that have the power now have the power to stop it. And so my prediction in the next 10 to 20 years is you're going to see those come head to head as people fight for their own rights again.
Mark?
Yeah, Barrick has a comment question.
So on that, when we talked about some of the other altcoins or the ICOs that are going on out there, are there already some that are looking at, I've been reading this and I've heard about some, like Steam that you talked about, I know they're trying to look at that, but there's also one called Scenario. So I think there are some that are starting this. Like you said, I think it's going to take a while for them to figure out how to get people to switch over, but how long do you think it'll take before that kind of happens?
Well, that's the golden question, because we have all these people running all these different coins, all these experiments, and we don't know what's going to fall. There'll be people that network around really good ideas. And as we talked about, that's the social consensus. There'll be some that have really super good ideas and smart people and the best machines and hardware, but if they don't have the hearts and minds of people, that doesn't do anybody any good. You know, Google Plus might have been better than Facebook. You know, I know for sure Betamax was better than VHS. We had both. But, it, you know, for whatever reason, the social consensus builds around one or the other. How long does that take? How long did the internet take to get out there, right? In the internet, pretty much 20 years from the, you know, the time of the early 90s when I first got involved with it before, you know, my grandparents got on. So, you know, that we had to do a whole infrastructure, right? We need to do routers and, you know, Cisco became the big thing back then. We needed websites to go to. People needed to realize, get over, you know, snail mail and get onto the whole idea of email. So there's a lot of attitudes that needed to change on that too. We have a lot of that infrastructure now. One of the things they really need are markets, though. You need to buy and sell this anywhere to be able to be liquid, at least these days. You know, there'll be other technologies that come around. But I'm expecting, you know, in the next 5 years, you're going to start seeing this just kind of settle, be random. You're going to see weird price, huge increases in price, and you'll see big crashes and other things, and you'll see wars and fights and whatever. It's going to be very tumultuous for the next 5 years at least. But after, you know, in the 5 to 10 years, in just my thinking, 5 to 10 years, you're going to see the people that was resisting it are going to run through the doors because they're late to the game. So you're going to have, right now you're having your early adopters, you have your pioneers right now, really. You guys are all pioneers. The 0.0001%, when someone says blockchain, you'd be able to tell them what it is. I bet if you walk down the street right now, have dinner, go to a restaurant, whatever, you would say the word blockchain in the restaurant, you might get 1 out of 100 that would say, oh, I know what that is. So you hear some people say, oh, blockchain is the new buzzword, everybody's doing it, and you know that's just going to die because they're, no way. Almost nobody could tell me what a blockchain is. That it's not, you know, we're at the, you know, very early stages of this. So in the 10 to 20 year range, it's going to be, there will be the new eBays and the new Facebooks and the new, you know, the new generation of the new companies will really be taking hold. So my thinking is I look for those things in the early stages. I knew about eBay. You know, in the very when they were a seed, I knew about Amazon in the very first. I was keeping up on this. I was the futurist, right? I just, you know, didn't have the money at the time to be doing what's with it. But, you know, I knew about these. So you guys are, if you keep up on them, you're going to start seeing the people that know what they're talking about start raising to the top. And so, you know, it won't necessarily just be a currency. It'll be people that are, know how to use the currency and build the influence and the social networks. And you'll see the rich stay rich. And so kind of keep track of what they're doing because they're going to be sinking money into the things they believe in. And generally, it takes money to make money, whatever. So if you're interested in that part of it, you know, just keep your heads above water. Keep paying attention to what's going on and then follow the money. You know, see what the rich people are what they're funding. Mark Andreessen, the visionaries, Mark Andreessen is one. So I like to see what Mark's in there because he knows what he's doing. And Warren Buffett. I watched an interview with Warren Buffett. Says that Bitcoin was just a blank check. Why would you invest the stupidest thing in the world? All it is a paper, like a paper check that you can send somebody. He didn't get. All he got was you could send money over, you know, borders. You know, you could put that, you saw that one tiny little aspect of it as a use case and thought that was it. And Mark Andrews says, well, I'm tired of being old white guys crapping on new technology, they don't understand. So you're gonna have some of that too. So the military, you know, they're gonna have secure communication through mesh networks that don't require an internet or satellites. It's gonna decentralize military command centers for fast, agile response. So they're gonna do a lot of the automation on these robots, how they can keep the robots, you know, talking to each other and keep the software, keep them from breaking down, right? These robots are gonna be on blockchains through mesh networks as well. They're gonna have private keys so hackers can't break into the robots and start, you know, shooting the wrong people or whatever. So blockchain's gonna be the backbone of all kinds of stuff in the military. Using Internet of Things is another example. Those robots are gonna be Internet of Things kinds of things. Non-currency uses more. Contracts. We're gonna reduce accountants, contract lawyers, auditors, bookkeepers, brokers, bankers, and more. So we're gonna have a big upheaval of people that will now suddenly be going, what do I do now? And we're seeing people in school right now. These colleges are putting out all kinds of people today that are gonna be regretting that they didn't take something useful because their jobs just went the way of making the buggies, the horse buggy whips. We'll still need some, I'm sure, but we're gonna see a lot of people that go, oh, you can be a piece of code, you can be a piece of code, you can be a piece of code. So look at yourself and wonder, can I, what I do, be done in a piece of code? It can move value, transfer value, be done with automated contracts that don't even involve and need to involve a person anymore. And there are people at the UN talking about this, and there are people at the World Bank talking about this. They know what's coming. They talked to, I know the one of the leaders of the Ethereum company, Consensus, just had a meeting with the UN last week. They know what's coming. They have to plan this out. They're trying to slow technology down some so they can have jobs for people to do. People identify themselves by the work they do, right? You doctor, you lawyer, whatever. What are you? You're an accountant. Pretty soon, you're going to have to stop identifying yourself with the job that you do. And we talked a little bit about the universal basic income. I've always hated that idea, huh? People who get paid for doing nothing. Hated that idea. It's communism, socialism. Hate it. And you see all this stuff happening at once, and you're like, oh. Even Bill Gates is, you know, saying, well, when people replace somebody with a robot, that robot needs to pay taxes because he's put someone out of work. What are they going to do? Now, we don't have ideas yet for what they're going to do. We need to really take care of the elderly. That's something that humans do really good. We need to take care of our sick people, take care of our, you know, the elderly people that really, you know, need help. Humane, human kind of jobs. That's something to look for. And that's a good thing. Who wanted to, who woke up, you know, when you're in kindergarten says, I want to sit down at a desk and put numbers in columns all day or whatever, sit at a computer screen. How fulfilling is that, dude, sitting at a computer screen, wasting your life away, you know, being unhealthy, being stressed. What kind of life is that, really? So people, I don't want to lose my job. And I say, did you imagine doing that job when you were in kindergarten? You wanted to be an astronaut. You wanted to do something cool. You wanted to be fly a jet. Do something cool. You know, this is going to free a lot of people up, and it's going to be hard for them personally. Fraud and corruption. The immutable public ledger will hold politicians responsible by auditing them. Remember, this is a public ledger. You could say, you know what, Congress, you give me that Bitcoin address that you're going to be spending those funds, and I'm going to watch where that goes. And it better be spent where you say it's going to be spent, because we want that address too. And we want the address of where they spend that. And pretty soon, you're going to see politicians realize that money is being watched. And can you think of any technology in the past million years or whatever that money was invented that can actually reduce or eliminate corruption? Corruption. You know, that's one of the biggest things, the biggest evils of men. You know, we go give money to these countries, you know, the International Monetary Fund, give it to Sudan or whatever to help. We throw money at problems. We throw money at people. And then we wonder why I didn't fix it. Where did that money go? And the, you know, the kings and the princes and whatever have all these great big new cars and houses or whatever, and the people stay poor. Well, this has a way, theoretically, of holding them responsible and accountable. And everybody says, even the corrupt ones will say, well, that's a great idea. Everybody else needs to stop their corruption. It's the prisoner dilemma. Everybody else needs to do it right, but I'm going to be a little bit ahead. game theory says that's going to come back to everybody's going to be pointing the finger at everybody, and it's going to happen, and you know, everybody's going to have to play by the same rules. That person who doesn't is going to stand out really quick. And I think even with charities today, you know, charities are some of the most corrupt organizations there are. You go to a website and it'll say, here's the top 100 most corrupt charities right now. Well, if you're a charity and I want to see, you know, prove to people that it's going to where I say that money's going to, I'm going to be on a blockchain. I'm going to say, here's my address. And here's the funding I'm going to give to the person who does the food. And here's the funding of the guy who does the delivery to the people. And here's the people themselves. And you can watch it. I guarantee you can watch the funds go to where exactly where I'm saying they're going to go to. And people are going to, what? Really? Okay, let's see that. Now, if I'm another charity and I see charity A do that, how long do you think I can get away with doing it the old way? Or I want to keep those funds hidden and opaque. Peer pressure alone is going to say, well, they're doing it. Why isn't anybody donating to me? So peer pressure alone is going to start collapsing the corruption in these organizations. And if you're the last corrupt charity, you're going to have to go away too. It could end corruption in charities. That could be one of the very first use cases. How about the Internet of Things? Devices that can calculate consensus autonomously and verify they're running the same signed code. We had, you know, a big section on the Internet of Things. So this is just highlighting one section. Remember the story about the guy that had the airplane had to get the wings rebooted? You know, there was a software glitch on his plane before they took off and said, wait a second, we're flashing the BIOS of our wings, essentially. And he says, well, you know, hackers could do that. What prevents the hackers from doing that? And then he talked about, well, what if the software component that was in the landing gear, the wings of this aircraft, there's another 100 aircraft that look just exactly the same as this one that was built by the manufacturer. What if you could check the software that was in the wings of all these other aircraft at the same time and make sure we're all running the exact same version of the code? It's been hashed, you know, and when you build those hashes, they can go through one way, they can only be prove that that's exactly the code that we're running, and it's tied to a, you know, a private hardware address as an Internet of Things kind of thing, that you could make things, you know, just one of a zillion examples of things that could talk to each other, verify each other on the same code base, and become, you know, essentially unhackable, because they're going to immediately, one gets changed, they're going to immediately stick out. They're going to, you know, they're all, you know, everybody's hashed exactly the same. And as soon as one changes, it's going to get red alert, or it's not going to allow itself to be changed because it'll be looking at everybody else and say, why am I different? So the Internet of Things is about to change a lot of things. The Web 3, the new internet replacement for mesh networks. This is the thing, the new rabbit hole I'm going to be going down. And I talked about this a little bit. Someone mentioned, hey, what have you been doing? You know, I've been on Facebook for the last 3 months. I've been awake till 2 in the morning every night putting this thing together for this blockchain class. And I said, blockchain? What's blockchain? And I said, in a nice Facebook polite kind of way, without going into big detail, I said, it's the new internet. I mean, how many ways could you describe blockchain? And this is the way that I'm going to be digging down further is the mesh networks. They're actually replacing the guy that built the first web. Tim Berners-Lee is heavily involved with building the replacement for the internet based on mesh networks. And Internet of Things and encryption and having your identity tied to you rather than a MAC address on a piece of hardware. So it follows you wherever you go. Whatever device you're on becomes, you become your own IP address. Very cool stuff going on, and they're pretty far along. There's a lot of cool teams working on that. And then next, we broke down the blockchain. This is where we got technical. You guys remember how to do a hash, what the hash function is? Running it through just a little bit of piece of code, a little black box of a mathematical problem you can download, run it on anything. Your phones can, you can download SHA-256, and there's a whole bunch of different kinds. But that's the foundation layer, that's your alphabet. Everything goes back down to a hash code. It's your language of immutability. They're one-way functions to encrypt every piece of data and sign everything that can't be changed and unwound. So you guys, if I told you to hash something, would you know how to do it right now? Said hash your name. Who could hash your name right now if I asked you to? Marty can hash his name, right? Anybody else?
You have to go to that website.
You go to, you get that one website, it's just one of a million places, right? You can download SHA-256 for Windows, for Linux, for your phone. It's, you know, a little command line, a little program. It's hard, it takes any space. Just runs through a little mathematical function. And that's, you know, the alphabet, the language, everything, the foundation block of everything in blockchain. Mining. If I ask you what mining is, anybody can tell me really fast, really easy. Someone says, well, what's this mining thing? It's not about Bitcoin, it's just mining stuff. No, they compute the hash of the transactions over time, lumping them together into regular blocks, hashing those full blocks before adding them to a permanent ledger. It's a race against all the other miners all over the world for reward. The reward is a side byproduct. So, did you guys build a miner? Went in with the, what was it, the seventh class, at the very end of the class, we gave the website where you could build your own coin. Transfer that to that little piece of software for you, so you could mine your own coin in your own house. It's pretty cool. I mean, that's probably the coolest, easiest way to learn about the blockchain right there in your house. I built the Mercury's coin. Anybody build a coin? Actually, use that. Give it a cool name. What did you build, James?
So I've built the yet, but I'm going to. I know. I haven't built it yet.
Oh, you didn't actually give it a name, whatever.
But I just have a link. I checked it out and I saw that.
Did you build one?
I did. I did pay the $50 for the cool pre-mine one that I could spend, you know, these coins and give my kids. It would just go, what? I don't know what to do with that. I can't figure out how to get consensus network, the social consensus, for people to spend the Mercury's coin. So if you can figure out that for me, what am I going to do that's different than everybody else that they'll want, they'll have to have a Mercury's coin and they'll want to mine it? I don't know.
You got to give some away to the class.
Give someone, oh, that's a good idea. It'll become, I can make them worth something by saying, you, this gets you half price to my next class, right? People that own this coin. And then you'll be going, Mercury, that guy was a great teacher. I'll tell you what, let's make an open market on this, and I'll sell this Mercury's coin for, you know, a couple Bitcoin at least. Gonna take two Bitcoin to pry this out of my hand, because that Mercury's is a great guy. The memory pool, everybody know what the memory pool is? Where your transactions go before they get put on the permanent ledger. If you know what happens to transactions that didn't pay a tip that are still waiting there for to be included, what's that called? The what? Sorry?
The orphan?
No, that's the orphan chain is for where they paid their dues or whatever, but they didn't get calculated by all the other miners yet, whatever. They weren't included in the chain that got used yet, but these are unconfirmed transactions, right? Got paid. I just transferred a bunch of money from one wallet to another, and it hasn't gone through yet. I actually did this before class. I thought, let me try just moving a little bit of money from. In fact, what I did is I tried to send money to this little paper, the wallet address on this piece of paper. And so I said, hey, let's scan it and just kind of see if it works, whatever. And my transaction just got stuck because you saw how much the price going up today. And then you go to blockchaininfo.com, and there's actually one of the charts, and they're called unconfirmed transactions. And as I mentioned, you can only fit about 2,200 transactions in that 1 megabyte memory block. Well, there have been tens of thousands of transactions trying to squeeze through there. So that gets bigger and bigger and bigger. It becomes a dam of unconfirmed transactions. And that's a big problem. This is one of the reasons Mike Kern quit. He says, this gets more popular. People are going to try sending Bitcoin through there and be trying to buy a cup of coffee or whatever, and it's going to be seeing it for a day or two. This gets stacked up. You guys aren't fixing this memory problem, this one-block memory pool problem. So you might see Bitcoin drop a huge amount of money just because it's not functioning as a payment right now. It's people are speculating on it, and it can't buy a cup of coffee without them paying an extra dollar for that cup of coffee to bribe people to process it.
So is a memory pool one place, or is it on all the a bunch of different computers?
Right. So the miners all process the same thing. They're running the same code, so they all share the same memory pool. Now the miners have the option to set some settings on their miners. Though they could set, there are some options they could do. It says I will only process transactions that pay 50 cents or more. And if I have people that pay no money, I'm never processing them. So they have the ability to set their memory to process certain, but they can also censor. In China, they worry about China allowing them to, if you're from this IP address or whatever, we're just not going to process your transactions at all. Or if you're this IP address, or you're this Bitcoin address that we know about and we don't like you, you're some kind of person trying to, freedom fighter from China or whatever, a dissident, It's possible they could, those miners can say, I'm just not going to process any transactions from this Bitcoin address too. They can actually censor transactions if they know about it. So all the miners can get that, so those same transactions though. So you might get lucky that one of the other miners that aren't in China, if you paid enough, will get it. And you know, like I said, they're all sitting in the same memory pool around everybody, and it's just what the miners decide they'll let through and what they won't let through.
So how do you know if your transaction is dropped off?
The transactions will drop off after a day if they haven't been canceled before. The wallets now, they really got stuck about a year ago, and people are like, well, it's been a day, I don't know, what do I get, a refund? I don't really know what's going to happen. And in the code itself, after so many blocks, it says if it hasn't processed through, then it goes back to the original address that it came from. Now, the wallets today, when I tried to send it to the wallet on this piece of paper here, it said stuck. It says, you know, kind of can't contact the network. I'm sure they're overloaded today. We looked at that chart. They're probably, you know, those unconfirmed transactions are probably a nightmare right now. But now it says, if you want to cancel, there's actually an option that will let me cancel that and send it right back to my wallet, which is what I did after a minute or two. I thought, well, it's going to be one of those heavy days knowing what the price is like today. Everybody, you know, you need to, as you're trying to buy those all-time highs, you were buying on-chain. And that means that all the people that are rushing to the fear of missing out are adding to that big transaction backlog. But they all share the same records, the same backlogs.
So if you want to pay the fee, how do you pay the fee?
Let's give you the microphone here.
So if you want to pay the fee, how do you pay? What's the process of paying the fee?
Right. So in your wallet itself, have you downloaded a Bitcoin wallet?
Yeah.
There's usually a slider mechanism in one of your tools, your options. It'll say, you know, some of them just will say small, medium, or large, or they might say slow, medium speed, or fast. Kind of the same thing. Your transaction is going to be processed really fast. And a lot of them won't say a dollar amount or a penny amount in there because they'll look out there at the memory pool transactions. They're smart enough to go look at what the current fee rate is right now. So they'll go, oh, well, you know, if you want to go through, it's going to cost you a buck. We don't want to say a dollar because this changes every day. But so you can do this little medium, and the good wallets at least will go there and look at what it's costing for transactions to go through and then dynamically adjust to that. Does everybody know how to do a fee then if you want to do a transaction? If you're doing a paper transaction, well, you're going to have to obviously sweep it into a phone wallet or sweep it into some computer type of thing, and then you know, just know that your software or whatever software you use has the ability to cancel and to do those kinds of things. And so read the reviews on the different websites. Do you have a question, James?
Oh,
you do? Okay. It's like you're doing an auction bid. It's like, $25. Sends back.
Mark, I was wondering what percentage was China controlling for the blockchain right now for Bitcoin? Was there a statistic on that?
So there's a lot of pie charts that you could go out there. It changes a little bit every day, but the big, I think there's five or six big miners, and it's over 60% right now. Some people say maybe even over 70%, because you can actually hide your mining. If you're a big mining pool, you can also put up another mining pool and call it something else and actually be the owner of more than one. And so there's some suspicion that some of them have even done that. The one mining company that had over 50% one time was called GHash. And it freaked enough people out that they left the mining pool because it was a public mining pool. People could go in there, you know, themselves, cloud the hash mining, they call it. And then now you don't even see it on the pie charts. Well, where did it go? I mean, companies like that just don't disappear. So there's some people saying, well, whoever the owner was and they had names for him, he might have broke it up and put it into a couple of little pools that wasn't so obvious. So who knows? That's this, kind of, sort of the scary part, but China has done some very interesting things lately. We saw them put restrictions on their some of their exchanges, the OK exchange, whatever, and they had two or three. They've always been a pain in the neck. In fact, I wrote about it, one of my first articles, the one that went to the Smithsonian Institute. I actually bring them up in the article, and I said, these guys are doing fake transactions. Even back then, they're reporting all of this business going on, and all it is two or three or five people, whatever, keep sending the same coin back and forth to each other, and it's all done off-chain, and then they're reporting as, you know, this is where all the this is where everything's happening. If you want to be the liquid market, you come and exchange on our exchange. And in the community, we all knew that these were fake. And they were doing a disservice, actually, because a lot of the mainstream media was like, well, 90% of the transactions happen in China. And we say, 90% of those transactions in China are fake. They're just people, you know, fake reported, these people sending it back and forth to each other. You know what really helped Bitcoin is if those guys got stopped from doing that. And then the press would get it right, and other people would get it right, and we could get some good, honest reporting about what's actually happening out there, not some big fake balloon number. And so when China came out and says, you guys can't do this anymore, and a lot of people, you saw the price of Bitcoin drop $200 or $300, and people in the, you know, the new one was going on, said, yes, finally, China got it right. They stopped all this baloney crap from going on, and all the idiots jumped out, but that's going to go right back up. Who cares? You know, they did us a favor. And then they come out just, you know, a couple of weeks ago to these same Chinese miners, and they said, you know what, you're doing money laundering here. We're looking at all the different mining places out here, and they're doing really good anti-money laundering and know your customer laws. Except you two guys, we had to get on because you're doing all this fake trading. No, your records aren't so good. So why don't we just redo? We're going to just withhold all of your withdrawals for 30 days while we figure this out, because you're doing some funny business. And then the market went, what? They're stopping transactions for 30 days? It must be broken. And a lot of people in the mainstream mass, you know, mainstream jumped out, so the price went down again. And everybody inside the Bitcoin community says, yes, they're finally bringing legitimacy and making sure they follow the same laws as all the rest of them. They did a good thing. So China, in their last three or four actions, have done great things for Bitcoin. And then they talk to the press, and some of the press says, well, you know, you got all this stuff, and you know, people are trying to get out of your money and your currency, and they're doing this thing called Bitcoin, and are you going to stamp it out? These mines are in China, and you could just issue an order like you do the banks and the press, and you could just stop it right now if you wanted to. And China says, we don't want to kill Bitcoin. We like Bitcoin. And so that caught a lot of people off guard. They thought, oh, someone's getting paid. And as James said, you know, nothing happens in China without four hands coming up. You grease palms of four different layers of people that get rich on this stuff. But they, you know, they need an income stream too. So a lot of people are worrying about China when China is probably our best friend. They're letting these mining things go. They're soaking up with the electricity that was just going to be wasted. They're on these dams. You know, it's not like they're so wasteful that somebody's having to be put out. Somebody's going to have to, you know, go in the dark because they don't get electricity. They're just siphoning off excess electricity. So they're providing a good. And China is happy about that. So, you know, a lot of people worry about the China thing and they're having a controlling interest. I think that will change. You know, as the processing power, you know, gets down to the atom level, right? We can't really shrink it much anymore without some massive new technology to come along. The chips are going to be spread around the world. You're going to start seeing them in Internet of Things devices talking to each other. They're going to be processing Bitcoin transactions because that's going to be those kinds of things on the network. That's going to be the mesh network, and they're going to have to be, that's going to be the communication layer and the privacy layer. So you're going to see these things built into everything. When they say, you know, 20 billion, 30 billion Internet of Things devices in the next, by, you know, 2025, they're going to be everywhere. And my suspicion is they're going to need that privacy piece. And they're going to be on the blockchain and probably pay for that. And those transactions, they're probably going to be doing a little bit of mining too. If the price goes up to hundreds of thousands of dollars, even mining just a tiny little bit could pay for its own electricity, could pay for itself. And you're going to see, you know, 20 billion things with mining chips in them. All of a sudden, you've got a completely decentralized mining operation. And then I know that even Samsung has been talking about putting a chip in the phones. So their phone could, you know, potentially host doing blockchain transactions, you know, built into the hardware. So very cool stuff. Signing. We did an experiment on there that we signed our own transaction in the wallet. Play with that. You know, sign some transaction. That's how the Internet of Things are going to do it. I did that as a kind of a concept thing because, I never signed that transaction and I looked at it. I had to sit there before I did the class, go figure it out, make sure that it worked because I wanted the theory down. Because that's what happens in the background with your wallets and the Internet of Things and all these things that will use their own private key, sign their own transactions, and that lets the other people know that it's not fraudulent. And then we talked about alternative blockchains. And there's two big major differences between them. We have the value, the bearer instruments that are really blockchains, and then we have the private permission intranets, you know, the distributed hash ledgers, you know, the IBMs doing the fabric, really a distributed hash ledger, a distributed ledger. And I like to really emphasize this point, that the intranet or permission, and you need to, you know, they trust their people, and you saw, you know, the big companies built intranets really fast. And most of them, you know, we have dead links on them. You know, people don't, the innovation leaves, the people that build them, there's not a lot of interest, whatever. They want to be where the innovation is. They want to be on the outside where it's permissionless. They can do big creative things. I tell you, Inner Mountains Internet is by far the best I've ever seen. They do a really good job at here at Inner Mountain, and they have a big intranet. The Great Divide. This is the IBM Hyperledger doing the big open distributed ledger consortium. They're really trying to get people in there. They're selling them like crazy. Come do amazing things with us. They're trying to get programmers in. And then Microsoft is the other fork of that road. They're doing blockchain as a service using Azure, and they're building it on top of Ethereum. And they have no problem if you want to build your own token coins that are bearer instruments. That's where I think the innovation is going to lead. You know, you can create your own coin that contains value and voting rights and sharing and all of this thing, all these things that create incentives that don't necessarily exist with a distributed ledger. And then we talked about social consensus, hearts and minds versus the best technology and hardware. So we look at the worst case scenario, China takes over all the Bitcoin miners and then do something bad with it. In fact, in a sense, they've sort of taken it over now because they're not that thrilled about changing, you know, that memory size. And there's a lot of division and debate going on. So what could we do? You know, if it's being controlled by 10 people, they control vast amounts of hardware, the decision-making comes up to 10 people. Well, do they hold the rest of the world hostage? 10 people? They haven't got the hearts and minds of everybody. They don't have social consensus. They might have a lot of influential consensus right now amongst the core developers. But if things like this transaction backlog keep happening, they lose the hearts and minds. And they will build a second blockchain, a second Bitcoin. They'll fork it and go around it. And if you guys have been watching the news, there's a lot of talk right now about forking Bitcoin itself. So we talked about the fork of Ethereum. What happens if they fork Bitcoin? We saw Ethereum just going to wild craziness and politics, and it confused a lot of people, and the price dropped and whatever. What would happen to the price of Bitcoin if that same thing happened? Anybody guess? What would happen to you? What happened to me when my Ethereum split? James has got an idea. Let's see what you say, James.
I would say, is that highly likely? But when Ethereum split, you know, you still had a small majority that was mining the old chain, and then you just ended up with ultimately two types of tokens. So you have, you know, traditional Bitcoin and then Bitcoin Classic again, right?
Yeah, that's exactly what you'd have. And they look at the polls and who supports which chain, and one wants to do segregated witness, and the other one's called Bitcoin Unlimited, and they want to do, they, you know, start with a 2 meg memory pool, but it dynamically adjusts itself. There's no reason we have to keep it a limit, and there's a lot of popularity for them. So if we start really looking at the numbers, you really had to pick a side, pick teams, they're pretty close to even now. It's pretty close to 50-50. If you really, really had to come down to it, and say, you know, they do the runoffs, right? They start with 6 people, and then they eliminate 3, and then now if you really have to pick between 1 or 2 or 3 or whatever. And so what it really comes down to, there's 2 major players of Bitcoin, and they're getting tired of each other and getting tired of the fights going on. I would not doubt it myself to see Bitcoin split. The payment manufacturer, you know, the people that do the Coinbases that need a lot of speed and want to become the Visa and have a lot of payments and do the rails and everything, they really like that idea. And then there's the other side. They really like the trust machine. They don't want to make any sudden changes. They love the idea of Bitcoin becoming the new gold. And there's a lot of, it makes a lot of sense for that too. So, to show of hands, what would you like to see? Bitcoin remain the massive trust machine and be like a gold that doesn't need a ton of movement at once? It just goes up in value when people trust it? Show of hands, who likes that idea better? Okay, show of hands, who likes the idea of becoming a payment network that everybody can get in and out, and it's fluid and it's liquid, and it can, you know, change the face of payments? And you can use that to protect your identity at Target and Walmart and all these things where you don't want people to know who you are. hard. You've got to be able to process a ton at once. So who likes that idea better?
Isn't that Ethereum based?
Yes.
Well, we're talking Bitcoin, right? We're talking the big coin that has the network effect that everybody knows. You talk to say the word Ethereum, most people know what you're talking about. It doesn't have social consensus yet. It hasn't. It's only been a year and a half old before it was live. It's still a baby. It can still tip over and fall over and have problems. It doesn't have the trust machine label on it yet. So I take it that most people like the gold idea. I think it was maybe 2/3 of the gold side, and then 1/3 on the Visa unlimited transaction side. Well, just one second, Brad.
So in looking at this online, I know there are some who have been in the Bitcoin community for a long time that actually like both sides. So I think there are some people who would like to see both sides try to come together to resolve it. I think that, with the Lightning Network and with SegWit, there's the potential to still have a, store of value as like gold on the main chain, and then have the side chains be more of that, the transaction processing. So I guess there would be a third option of compromise. Like you said, it's very unlikely, but I think there are those out there promoting that as well, right?
Yeah, there's a lot of conflict of interest charges going on. The people that are doing Lightning Network, and there's another one called Rootstock. Rootstock's trying to be an Ethereum sort of thing, building a whole ecosystem on top of Bitcoin itself. So there's a lot of opinions out there. What happened with me when I had my Ethereum split? I also had two coins. I had half of them on Ethereum Classic, and I had half of them on the new Ethereum. I loved that. I just had $10,000 given to me out of nothing, out of thin air. So if Bitcoin splits, anybody who owns Bitcoin will have two Bitcoin. And that might lose a little bit of credibility because people say there's only going to be 21 million Bitcoin ever developed. Well, if you split in two, now you got 21 million ever developed on that side, 21 million ever developed on that side, you're going to see the price crash. You'll see the price go way down probably as people freak out, try to figure out what does this mean. And then eventually they'll come around and go, that means we got two Bitcoin. We have one doing gold, that's awesome. And we have one doing payments, that's awesome. And they don't even have to be the same thing, except the people who owned that before the split, we got one of each. Twice the pleasure, single the fun. But it will freak people out for a while until it settles down and they realize, oh, things are still working. Things will still work just like they used to, except one has slower amount of transactions, but super trustful. The other one does a whole lot of fast transactions, but people say it's not as trustful because, they're running fast blockchains, things get mixed up in there, lose transactions, and it's not as proven. So, who knows? Eventually, I would imagine that they would figure it out even if there were problems.
They answered my question.
Oh, okay, good. So a little bit more about the alternative blockchains. We talked about the four major categories of these alternative ones. If you look on the CoinMarketCap, they kind of break down to four major categories, right? We have the open trust-based tokens like Bitcoin and Litecoin. They are based on your tokenizing trust. Those are not going to be corrupted. Whatever is there and won't leave. They have the open-based, the privacy blockchains like the Monero, Snero, the Dash coins. They have a use case. Then we have the ecosystem for the entire network storage hardware, which is Ethereum and MaidSafe. That's a whole other world that opens up. That's the window to a whole other dimension. And you have the app-based coin, the coins, the apps, ICOs that are coming along, Golem, Factum being examples. We talked a little bit about the sidechains. They actually have sidechains on Ethereum too. There's a Lightning network called Radian that actually works with Ethereum, that you're gonna get super fast transactions as well. And Rootstock is the Ethereum on top of blockchain or on top of Bitcoin. And then lastly, we talked about Ethereum. What is Ethereum? If you had to tell me what Ethereum was after last class, what would you say? Cool. Raise your hand if you think it's, if you had to say one of these terms to your buddy that this asked you about, what would you use? Is it the world computer? Is it the open system for building smart contracts and programmable language that's built on a full programmable language? Would you tell them, oh, it's a system where miners validate transactions, but also do all the calculations to compute the contracts in massive redundancy? That means if this computer goes down and doesn't process the transaction, well, I only got about 10,000 more that will do it, take its place as soon as it drops off the network. So massive resiliency to conduct transactions. And the redundancy ensures that contracts cannot be stopped or censored that come back to haunt them when the DAO went down. Vitalik already said, we can't do anything. That thing is going to go until it goes. No one can stop that code. Just like they said, it's unstoppable. So they pulled the rug out from under it and stopped the blockchain and kind of did some things they probably, in retrospect, probably would have done again if they had to do it over, knowing what happened after. But they, in my opinion, they grew a lot of wisdom. Or people now that review the code have all kinds of new use cases to watch that very carefully. We all learn from our mistakes. There's a toddler hacking his way through a forest that had never been through. We're in uncharted territory. It would be weird if something didn't go wrong once in a while. I would not trust it as well as actually seeing it tested and see how they recovered. Actually watch them learn the wisdom and learn things they didn't know about before. So I actually gained a lot of respect and a lot of trust watching them hit their first bump, fall down, and get back up. Or is Ethereum the method of payment of delivery for every calculation paid on the Ethereum network, thus giving it an intrinsic value? We talked about dApps and DAOs. The dApps are decentralized applications. The DAOs are the whole organizations that run all those contracts. And then they can all be accessed and utilized with the new browser called Mist that invokes them. And there'll be others other than Mist, but you'll be able to go hit the different applications that you like as you need. And I talked about one a little bit, an idea I was trying around. Why don't we create a dApp called March Madness? And I don't think there is one right now. So you have a little application out there that looks at oracles and say, here's my 64 teams. What if you think, you know, everybody has a little office bet, you know, on their, you know, March Madness thing. And, you know, everybody puts a little bit into the pool, and if the first round all win, you get a certain amount, and then that builds into the chain of the second round, and they all win, right? So what are the odds that everybody gets all, every team exactly right? I don't know if it's ever happened, that someone picked every win, you know, even the underdogs, there's always surprises that win. But if you create an app that you could get out there and say, you know what, this is a worldwide March Madness app, and when I win, I'm going to win big. Because the world becomes its own gravity well. As people, you know, see the, you know, the big lotteries go, and it reaches $1 million, all these idiots that can't do math are running in and sink more money into this gravity well of lottery tickets. Well, you could see the same kind of idea with a March Madness DAP. And so if I could code in Ethereum really well, I'd just go build me one, make it available, and say, here you go, guys, just spend a little bit of Ethereum. You're going to be the winner. We guarantee you. You're going to be the winner of all this. And then for me, for building that DAP, 1% comes to my own Ethereum address. So that's my reward for building this awesome DAP that everybody can use. And then I don't have the control of it. As soon as I build it, running oracles, I can be done with it. Next year, it looks at the oracles, reshuffles and builds the next one. So this is going to go on for all this milk back out for years. So anybody want to build me a March Madness app, I'll do it. Someone just did?
This
wow, jerks took my idea. Everybody takes my ideas. I invented Facebook a decade before the Facebook big crazy Facebook. I was going to call it the meat market though. The M-E-E-T market. I had it all in my head going. Dang, Mark Zuckerberg. Then we talked about oracles a little bit, the data sources that bridge the real world to the virtual world for the contracts. And they're mostly going to be machines, Internet of Things, but you're going to have some people probably as well in there too. But I'm going to be trusting the machines probably. And then we have talked about the APCO tokens. Those are built with ICOs, initial coin offerings. New type of funding security. The important part of that is we don't know if they're legal. I watched a lot of YouTube videos with a lot of lawyers in the last week, and there was a lot of people said, I don't care what country they were built in. The United States will come after them if they're bought in America. It doesn't matter if they're in Lithuania or whatever. If somebody in the United States can purchase a security and they're not licensed to offer that security, we can come and get them. And so they're trying to word very carefully about how they do these ICOs. They're trying to tell people it's not a security. Don't expect, you know, don't expect profit and all that stuff. So we'll see. It's still uncharted territory, but just know that if you buy these, you're in the United States. In fact, Iconomy, I think you couldn't buy it if you're in America. If you tried to go to Iconomy's websites in Europe and they detect you're coming from an IP address in the United States, I don't think they would sell to you. So when I bought some Iconomy tokens, I had to do it on an exchange in Kraken, you know, that's in Europe. And I think I had to go through a VPN so it didn't look like I was coming from America to be able to buy the tokens there. So be very careful if you're doing that kind of stuff until they figure out. And they said just because they haven't talked about it now doesn't mean they're not talking about it and behind closed doors. And they may sit on it for a couple of years, but then go and break out the trouble.
So what does that mean for you if you are the purchaser? Because you kind of talked about the companies that are offering the ICO and that, our government could go after them, but what about the citizens that purchase the ICOs?
From what I understand, the citizens that buy it are now shareholders, they're owners of this company. So you can be in trouble too. Now, the saving grace of that is, how do they know it's you? You just bought it with an Ethereum address. You are a token ID. You don't have a name unless they know exactly, could put a name to the address. That's the weird thing. They don't know how to regulate is, well, how do we know they're American? And how do we know, because all they are numbers. All we know is they've got some weird hash number. And we don't know more than that. And maybe they could do some NSA research and kind of start tying things and watching all these blockchains or whatever. Maybe they spend the time, maybe they don't. Maybe they think, well, we're just a new world. We've got to come up with new laws because these were written in the 1930s. And maybe, they don't apply anymore. So my guess is they're going to rework stuff and figure stuff out. But there's still going to be a lot. The reason they were written is because a lot of people got taken. They were written in the 30s and then people could just go scam everybody. And so they were built. The laws were written to protect the innocent, dumb people that couldn't see past the phonies and the Ponzi schemes. Well, we're entering a new area where you're going to see scammers and Ponzi schemes. And there's going to be people scream and cry and say, government, why didn't you protect me from that? I didn't know better. It's your job to know better than protect me. So there will be some of that happen again in the new paradigm. And so, we're going to have to figure that out as well, too. So just be aware when you're doing that kind of stuff that it may be, illegal at some point. And, you might have to give up some money. You might be able to, say, I didn't know the rules or whatever, and they might be lenient with you. But just be aware. I've told you enough, you can be dangerous. Final question. Select your best answer. This is the very last slide. What is the blockchain? I'll give you multiple choice. Is it a public ledger? Anybody show hands? Public ledger blockchain. It's what when you hear a lot of people, you bring it up, they say, oh, that's just a public ledger. When they tell the mainstream newscaster or whatever. Is it, I've heard people call this, it's a giant spreadsheet with quadrillions of cells of data that you can put in there. Well, Bitcoin's got 2.1 quadrillion addressable units. Quadrillion. 21 million coins, 100 million ETH. Yeah, 2.1 quadrillion, that's true. A necessary transaction log of token ownership? Well, every blockchain I've seen, records tokens and records ownership and privacy. Yeah, okay. B, is it the single source of trusted truth, or the trust machine, as the economist puts it? Is it? Can you count on the blockchain, at least Bitcoin blockchain, to not be corrupted? And when you put something there in a transaction, how hard would it be to go re-mine and before the rest of the network can be fooled? Remember the stats on that? How many supercomputers equivalent of Bitcoin it would take? Six Bitcoin mining operations to go back, 3 blocks ago? So, and the power, generated from probably England and France, combined electrical power. Yeah, that trust would be tough to break. Is it a shared record where anybody can read, but only a privileged few have the money to write to? You have to own the Bitcoin to write to the ledger. Everybody can read them. Is it a new dimension in computer science that defies all previous concepts? And that's maybe what I would say. Or is it a complex subject matter that would require additional years of study and evolve so quickly that it becomes a bottomless rabbit hole to explore and discover? That's my... So it's something I can't explain to somebody in polite conversation. As I tried to last night, someone asked me at dinner, what's blockchain? And as I got 3 minutes into it and I saw the eyes go glossed over, I said, never mind. I got 16 hours of class you can go to. And maybe by the end, you can tell me what a blockchain is. So, with that, anybody want to tell me what a blockchain is? I'll leave it. Good. So that's the end. That's the end of 16 hours. Thank you.